بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. Dear students, assalamu alaikum. Today is the 16th lecture of numerical analysis, and I will be talking about the Simpson rules and its composite form. This is another rule for the computation of the numerical integration. Let's see that how we can derive the Simpson rule. In this case, we consider three points. You saw in case of trapezoidal rule that we consider two points and obtained the formula for the trapezoidal rule, which was the simple rule, and then extended it to the n plus 1 number of points, in other words, n number of subintervals. In this case, we are considering just three points: x0, f of x0, x1, f of x1, and x2, f of x2. In a similar fashion, there the data is equally spaced. Let's see that how this can work. Since there are three points, so we can find out Lagrange polynomial of degree 2. You can use the Lagrange polynomial, you can do the integration and can derive the formula also. But here, I am considering the Taylor series and expanding the function f of x about x is equal to x1. That's the central point of your data. You are having three points, so x1 is the central point, and I expanded the function f of x using the Taylor series, which is the well-known expression, you know about that. F of x1 plus x minus x1 prime of x1 plus x minus x1 square divided by 2 factorial second order derivative at x1, and I stopped at the x minus x1 raised to the power 4. Fourth order derivative of the function. You know that eta is the function of x, and that will lie between x0 and x2 as usual. Why I am going up to fourth order derivative? The reason is straightforward, that some of the factors become a zero when we do the integration. So that's the reason. If I stop here, so this portion becomes zero when we do the integration, so we will have no error term. But remember, error term is always there. Let's do the integration between the points x0 to x2. Simple integration, f of x1 is a constant, so it will come outside. And we will have dx only. A prime of x1 is constant, so it will come outside. We will have x minus x1. Similarly, f second order derivative at x1 divided by 2 factorial is constant, so we have the integration of x minus x1 whole square. Similarly, triple order derivative at x1 of the function divided by 3 factorial is constant, so that is outside. Integration of x minus x1 whole cube and integration of this whole term, because eta is the function of x. Let's do the integration. Integration of 1 is x between the limits. Its exact derivative is 1. So when you do the integration, that will be x minus x1 whole square divided by 2. Exact derivative of x minus x1 is 1. So raise the power by unity divided by the same power. Similarly, exact derivative is 1. So raise the power by unity divided by the same power. Now look at this one. Product of two functions. The problem which I will be facing is that of the, we don't know the explicit relation for eta. So we apply here the weighted mean value theorem. And you can see that this function is not going to change its sign, it's integrable. And this is This is continuous function. Because always remember, in case of the Taylor series, we know that fourth order derivative, the function of the fourth order derivative should be continuous, and fourth order derivative will exist. So we apply the weighted mean value theorem. There exists a point between x0 and x2 such that this term outside come outside by weighted mean value theorem. So I can see that I consider that point as eta, as I discussed in case of the trapezoidal rule. So it's exactly the same as we did there. Now just apply the limit. So this will be x2 minus x0. Similarly, x2 minus x1 whole square minus x2 minus x0 minus x1 whole square. And this will be x2 minus x1 whole cube minus x0 minus x1 whole cube. This will be x1 minus x2 minus x1 whole 4 minus x0 minus x1 whole raised to the power 4. And this will be x minus x1 whole. This integration will be x minus x1 raised to the power 5 divided by 5. Because the exact derivative of x minus x1 is 1. So exact derivative is this. We can find out the integration using the power formula. As I discussed right now, I just applied the limits over here. And similarly, the limits in the last term. Upper limit minus the lower limit. So let's simplify, because we know that the step size is the same, and that's given by h. So x2 minus x0 is 2h. You can see it over here. X2 minus x1 is equal to h. So this is h square minus x0 minus x1 is minus h square, but square will make it positive. X2 minus x1 is h raised to the power 3. Minus x0 minus x1 is minus h raised to the power 3. X2 minus x1 is h raised to the power 4. X0 minus x1 is minus h raised to the power 4, which will make it positive again. And this will come over here. This is x2 minus x1, h raised to the power 5, minus x0 minus x1 is minus h raised to the power 5. So let's simplify it. H square minus h square, this portion will become 0. Minus h raised to the power 4 will become h4. So this portion will become 0. And we will left with 2hf of x1. This will be 2h cube divided by 6, so which is h cube divided by 3, second order derivative at x1. And this will become 0. This will be 2h raised to the power 5. So 2 will cancel. So you are having h raised to the power 5 divided by 60 and fourth order derivative. The question is, here is the second order derivative. So let's substitute the value of the second order derivative. And this is the second order derivative. You already know I presented it in front of you. But remember, we want to find out the derivative at x is equal to x1. So replace x0 by x1 in this formula to get the value of f, second order derivative at x1. 2h f of x1 there is 2. 2hf of x1 is there. So there is a 2 is missing. You can write is there, so you can write 2. So 2hf of x1 minus h cube divided by 3, and if I replace x0 by x1, so this will be x1 minus h, which is there. This will become f of x1. This will become f of x1 plus h. minus h square divided by f l. You can see that it lies between x naught minus h and x naught plus, this will replace by x1 minus h and x1 plus h. And this is the term which we reproduced. Just simplify it. This h square will cancel with that one, so you are having h divided by 3. X1 minus h is x0. 2 divided by 3 into h, f of x1. And this will be h divided by 3, f of x2. Minus h cube multiplied by h square is h raised to the power 5. 3 multiplied by 12 is 36. Fourth order derivative. And this is the order. Now you can see eta lies between x naught and x2. And you know the rule of this eta. Similarly, eta 1 lies between x naught and x2. It plays the same role as this one. So I can say that these are basically eta 1 and eta, they are the same numbers. Such that for upper bound of the error, fourth order derivative of the function is absolutely maximum at these values. So I can replace eta 1 by eta because both are the same points. Reproduce the previous value and now let us simplify it. H divided by 3 is common. So f of x naught. Now you can see 2h minus 2h divided by 3. This will be 6h minus 2h, which is 4h divided by 3, which you can see over there. And of course the sign will be positive. H by 3 is common. And if you simplify these two, because I told you eta 1 and eta, they are the same numbers. So when you simplify them, you are getting this value. And this is called the Simpson rule of integration. The difference between trapezoidal rule and Simpson rule is, in case of trapezoidal rule, integration was between two consecutive points. But remember, it is not between two consecutive points. It's between x0 and x2. So there is another point, third point, in between also. So you have to be careful that this method is applicable only when there are three points are multiple of, there are three points or more. But how that will become clear in the next composite form of the trapezoidal rule, that what should be the number of points in this case. So remember, trapezoidal rule, you can apply this rule, you can apply when there are x0, x1 and x2. You are doing integration from x0 to x2, so there will be three points. Now let's consider an example. The question is, apply Simpson rule to approximate the following integral. Integral is given to you. So definitely, this is the formula. This is the formula. And if you do the comparison, x0 is equal to 0 and x2 is equal to pi divided by 4. So from this information, find out the value of h. You know that xi is equal to x0 plus I into h. X0 is 0. And this is the value of x2 is equal to pi by 4. So x2 is equal to x0 plus 2h. The value of x2 is pi by 4. If you do the comparison, the value of x0 is 0 plus 2h. So find out the value of h from there. So h is equal to pi divided by 8. This is our function which we will be using. X0 is the lower limit, x2 is the upper limit, and h we discussed right now. We have all the information, so now let's go for the application of the Simpson rule. This will be h, the value of h is pi by 8, so this will become pi divided by 24. F of x naught, the value of x naught is 0. The value of x1 is equal to x naught plus h. X naught is 0, h is pi by 8, so 0 plus pi by 8. So f of pi by 8, and f of x2 is pi by 4. Now the function is known. Substitute the value of x. In other words, replace x by 0, x by pi by 8, and x by pi by 4. So when you replace x by 0, so this becomes 0. When replace x pi by 8 over here, so this is the value we are getting. And when we replace x by pi by 4, so we are getting this value. Remember, you have to be careful. Your computer must be in radians, otherwise you will be getting the wrong value. And when you simplify it, this is the approximated value of your given integration. This is the application of the Simpson rule. Now let's come to the composite form of the Simpson rule. In composite form of the Simpson rule, we need more points, and we consider, let's consider another example. This is an example. Apply the Simpson rule to find out integration. Let's identify the values. So this is the value of x, f of x. This is the value of x naught, and this is the value of x2. Because you know that this is the formula, if you do the comparison, x0 is 0.75, x2 is 1.75. This is your function. The point is, we have to find out the value of h. The value of h is equal to, this is x2, x2 is x0 plus 2 into h. X0 plus 2 into h. So 1.75 minus 0.75 divided by 2. So 1 divided by 2 is 0.5. You got the value. Now just substitute the values over here. So this is 0.5 divided by 3. F of x naught. X naught is 0.75 plus f of x1. So x naught plus h. 0.75 plus 0.5 is 1.25 plus f of x2, which is there. Function is known. Xi's are known. Just substitute the values. This is the value of the function at x is equal to 0.75. This is the value of the function at x is equal to 1.25. And this is value of the function at x is equal to 1.75. Just do the calculation and you will get the approximated value of your integration. So this is approximated value of the integration using the Simpson rule. Composite form of the Simpson rule. Composite form of the Simpson rule, now we are given n number of points. But remember, this time there will be some restriction on this n. Why? Integration from x0 to x2 because of the formula. Because we are doing integration from x0 to x2, then from x2 to x4, then from x4 to x6, and then from xn minus 2 to xn. So you can see that we skip the central point in all the cases. If you look at this, the upper limit, this is x2, x4, x6. So it means that this n must be an even number. And that I was telling you, that there should be a condition on this n. So if n is a not even number, then you can't apply the composite form of the Simpson. That is an important condition on n. Remember, there are two points starting from x naught, n at xn, but this n must be an even number. If it is not even, remember the composite Simpson rule is not applicable. Your answer is straightforward. N is not even, the number of points will be odd, but this n will be even. Otherwise, composite Simpson rule is not working. Let's imply this. This is the Simpson rule. So let's look at this one. The value at the initial point, then value at the central point, then value at the end point. So if I look at it, this will be h divided by 3. I told you data is equally spaced data. So we are talking about equally spaced data. That's why I'm using h. This will be f of x naught plus 4 f of x1 central point plus f of x2 minus h5 divided by 94th order derivative of the function. Its value, this will be f of x h divided by 3 f of x2 plus 4 f of x3, which is the central point, plus f of x4 minus h5 divided by 94th order derivative. I call this eta is eta 2. Similarly, if I go for this one, h divided by 3 f of x4 plus 4 f of x5 plus f of x6 minus h5 divided by 90, I call this is eta 3. And finally, f of xn minus 2 plus 4 f of xn minus 1 plus f of xn. Again, I'm telling you, this is applicable only when n is even and total number of data points are odd, because we are starting from x naught and data is equally spaced. Data is equally spaced. I told you before, when h appears there and there's the constant throughout, so it means that your data is equally spaced. Unequally spaced, this formula will not be a suitable choice. There should be an alternate form, and I don't think so that that will be this simple to derive. The value of this is between x0 and x2, x2 and x4, that's why I'm writing 2i, so between the even numbers, the value of eta lies. Let's combine them. H divided by 3, h divided by 3, h divided by 3, h divided by 3, that is common. F of x naught and f of x, and there is no any other term, so I put it over here. Now, 4 f of x1 plus 4 f of x3 plus 4 f of x5, you can see over here, plus 4 f of xn minus 1. F of x2 is here and f of x2 is there, so this is 2 f of x2. F of x4 plus f of x4, 2 f of x4. And finally, there will be term before this term, so that will involve f of xn minus 2. So f of x minus 2 from there and f of x minus n minus 2 from here gives you 2 f of xn minus 2. Similarly, the error terms, h5 divided by 90, h5 divided by 90, h5 divided by 90, and h5 divided by 90. So I'm taking them common. Why I'm putting here eta subscript n by 2? Look at your situation. This is x2, so 2 divided by 2 is 1, so I'm putting it 1 here. This is the last term is x4, 4 divided by 2 is equal to 2, so I'm putting 2 there. The last term is x6, and 6 divided by 2 is 3, so I'm putting it over here. Last term is n, so n divided by 2, and I told you n is an even number. That's the reason I am writing this subscript n by 2. If n is not even, so we can't write it. And I think it's clear that why I'm writing in this subscript. if I take h raised to the power 5 divided by 90 with negative sign common, so fourth order derivative at eta 1 plus fourth order derivative at eta 2 plus fourth order derivative at eta 3 and plus fourth order derivative at eta n divided by 2. Let's write them in summation form. So f of h divided by 3 is common, f of x naught plus f of x n is there, 4. You can see that this is f of x 1, x 3, x 5, x n minus 1. So these are odd subscripts. And that's the reason I use 2i minus 1. I is starting from 1. I is starting from 1. So when I is equal to 1, so 2 minus 1 is x1, and you can see x1 is there. I is equal to 2, this will be 4 minus 1, which is 3, x3 is there. I is equal to 3, so this will be 2 multiplied by 3, 6 minus 1 is 5, so 5 is there. And finally, if I put this 2i minus 1 is equal to x minus 1. 2i minus 1 is equal to n minus 1. So minus n minus, this will cancel. And 2i will become n. And I is equal to n divided by 2. That's the reason I am putting n divided by 2 there, because that is the last term. Similarly, if you look at these terms, starting from 2, x2, x4, up to xn minus 2. If n is even, n minus 1 is odd, and n minus 2 is even. That's the reason I am putting subscript in the multiple of 2i, because it represents even numbers. When I is equal to 1, you are getting x2. When I is equal to 2, you are getting 4. And 2i minus 2 is equal to n minus 2 gives you I is equal to n minus 2 divided by 2. That's the reason I am putting the last limit over here. When you replace it over here, 2 and 2 will cancel and you will get n minus 2. Exactly, that's the last term of your this summation. Minus h5 divided by 90. Eta 1, eta 2, eta 3 up to n minus 1. So you can see it starting from 1 reaching up to n divided by 2. Composite form of the trapezoidal rule. This is clear. This is the approximated value of your integration. This is the error term. As I discuss in case of the trapezoidal rule, you have to find out absolutely maximum value of the fourth order derivative in every subinterval in this interval, because eta 1 lies between x0 and x2, eta 2 lies between x2 and x4, eta 3 lies between x4 and x6, and similarly eta n by 2 lies between xn minus 2 and xn. So you need to find out locally absolutely maximum value, and for this computation, and then you have to add them, which is not that straightforward, because if you're having a large data and you are looking for the local extrema in every subinterval, so that will be a tedious job. So the target is to, let's replace this by a single value. Instead of local, let's focus on the global value. You can see that this is your error term. Now let's focus on this error term exactly in a similar fashion as you did in case of the trapezoidal rule. Local extrema is greater or equal to the global minimum and less are equal to the global maximum, because you know that the global maximum, I'm taking from x0 to xn, so I'm covering the complete, the whole set. Global maximum is the largest value, so it is obvious that this is the largest value. Global minimum is the smallest value, so that's the reason I say this global minimum, the smallest value, is less or equal to the local extrema local extrema is less or equal to the global maximum, as we did in case of the trapezoidal rule. This is the error term. So you can see in this case, summation is from 1 to n by 2. So let us take summation throughout. I have taken summation throughout, but again, if you look at it, this is independent of I. And I'm adding a constant term n by 2 times. So this will be constant term multiplied by n by 2. Again, this is a constant term with respect to I. There is no any I, so it means that I'm taking the summation of a constant term n by 2 times. So this will be n divided by 2 multiplied by this term. That's the reason you can see n by 2 instead of this summation. You can see n by 2 in this summation. And this I have written as such because my focus is on this summation. Now let's multiply throughout by 2 by n. So this n by 2 will cancel. Here 2 by n will appear. And this n by 2 will cancel. Now, again there is an intermediate mean value theorem and states that if a function is continuous, so of course fourth order derivative in this case is continuous when we were expanding the using the Taylor series. This is continuous and sum of continuous function is continuous, so I can say this summation is continuous. And if I multiply continuous function by a constant, it will remain continuous. If you have a continuous function and a number k lies between the initial and the final point, such that this k is greater than the minimum value of that function and smaller than maximum value of the function, that in that interval a point exists such that k is equal to value of the function at that point which exists. So the similar fashion is here. This is the minimum value of the function, but remember this time the function is fourth order derivative of the function. This is maximum value. And this is a number k which lies between minimum and maximum value. Then there exists a point, I call that as eta in that interval, such that fourth order derivative at eta is equal to this k. So you can see that we replace the summation by a single term. But that is the target. So let's multiply both sides by n by 2. So your summation will be equal to n divided by 2 fourth order derivative at eta. This is the approximated value of the integration which we derived the last slide. This is the error term, h raised to the power 5 divided by 90. But remember, when this go there, so this is n divided by 2. So n divided by 2, 2 multiplied with 90 is equal to 180. This is called the composite form of the Simpson rule. So this is the composite form of the trapezoidal rule. But you know that this is the partition of the interval from A to B. So x0 is equal to A, xn is equal to B. And we know that xn is equal to x0 plus n into h. Yeah, n into h is equal to xn minus x0. Or n into h is equal to b minus a. So let me replace n into h by b minus a. N into h is b minus a, so you will left with h raised to the power 4 divided by 180. So this is the alternate form of the composite form of the Simpson rule. So you can use this form as well as this form, both should give you the same answer. So we derived the composite form of the Simpson rule. Now let us consider an example that how we can apply this composite Simpson rule. This is the integration given to us. Integration from 0 to 2, x square log of x square plus 1. This time you can see that the value of h is given to you. When h is given to you, then you have to find out the value of, because this is the composite form, you should know about the value of n. So you have to find out n. This is the composite form of the Simpson rule. Look at this one. Integration is from a to b. B is xn. And b is equal to 2 in this case. You know that xn is equal to x0 plus n and h. The value of xn is 2. The value of x0 is 0. H is known. So from this you can see that 2 divided by 0.25 is equal to n, which comes to be 8. And I told you that in case of the composite Simpson rule, this n must be an even number. If you take odd, this formula will not work. And straightforward from here, if n is odd, so you can't do the division. So how you will accommodate this one? So the value of n is 18. It is 8. 8 is an odd number, so we can apply the composite form. Value of the function x naught, as I told you, xn I told you, and you got the value of n is equal to 8. Just the matter of substituting the values. N is equal to 8. Integration is from 0 to 2, h divided by 3, f of a is 0, f of 2 is b, so you got this value. N is 8, so 8 divided by 2 is equal to 4. 8 minus 2 is 6, 6 divided by 2 is equal to 3. So you can see that I transform this summation to this form. Now just expand it and substitute the values. F of x naught, f of x 8 plus 4, I is equal to 1, so you are getting f of x 1, I is equal to 2, you are getting f of x 3, I is equal to 3, you are getting f of x5, I is equal to 4, so 4 multiplied by 2, 8 minus 1 is 7, f of x7. So this is the expansion of this summation plus 2 multiplied by I is equal to 1, so this is f of x2, I is equal to 2, this is f of x4, I is equal to 3, this is f of x6. Remember, h is known, x0 is known, so you can find out a list of xi's. F of x naught is f of 0, f of x 8 is f of 2, f of x 1 is 0 plus h, h is 0.25. 0.25 plus h is 0.75, this is the 0.25 plus h is 0.5, this is x 1. X1 plus h, 0.5 plus 0.5 is 0.75, this is x3. X3 plus h, 0.75 plus 0.2h is 1. So f of 1, you can see. F of 4, x3 plus h. So this is f of 1. 1 plus h is 1.25. And that is x5. So you can see x5 is 1.25. 1.25 plus h is x6, which is 1.5, so f of x6 is 1.5, and similarly 1.5 plus h is x7, which is 1.75, and you can see it over there. Now function is known, xi's are known, just substitute the values and your final answer will. So you can see that using the composite Simpson rule, you got the approximated value of your integration. This was example number 3. Now let's consider another example. Apply Simpson rule to approximate the following integral. Remember, this time n is given to you. In the previous example, h was given to you, now n is given to you. composite form of the Simpson rule. The value of A, which is x naught, is 2. The value of B is equal to xn, and xn is equal to x8 this time, which is equal to 2. X naught is 0, x8 is 2. So find out the value of h. Xn is equal to x naught plus n into h. Xn is x8, which is 2. X naught is 0, n is 8. So find out the value of h from here, which is 2 divided by 8, and 2 divided by 8 is 0.25. So you know all the values over here now. Value of the function, x naught, x8, and h we have computed. Just substitute the value in the composite form. The value of n is equal to 8. So this will be 8 divided by 2, which is equal to 4. This will be 8 minus 2 is 6 divided by 2 is equal to 3. Exactly like the previous question. F of x0, f of x8 plus 4. I is equal to 1, f of x1, I is equal to 2, f of x3, I is equal to 3, f of x5, I is equal to 4, f of x7. And similarly here, I is equal to 2, f of x2, I is equal to 2, f of x4, I is equal to 3, f of x6, and we completed this summation also. Just everything is known, find out the values. So look at it carefully. F of x0 is f of 0. F of x8 is f of 2. X1 is x0 plus h. X0 is 0. 0 plus h is 0.25. X1 plus h is x2. So 0.25 plus 0.25 is 0.5. That is x2. Now x2 plus h. The 0.5 plus 0.25 is 0.75, that is equal to x3. So f of x3, the value is there. X3 plus h, 0.75 plus 0.25 is equal to 1. And that is x4, so the value of x4. Now x4 plus h, 1 plus 0.25 is 1.25, and that is x5. So the value of x5 is 1.25. 1.25 plus h is x6. 1.25 plus 0.25 is 1.5, which is x6. So f of x6. And 1.5 plus 0.25 is x7. And x7 is 1.75, which is over here. We know all the values of xi's. Function is known. Replace x by xi's and you can get all these values. When you do the calculation, this is the approximated value of your integration using the composite form of the Simpson rule. So this is another example. In one example, h was known. In the second example, n is known. And we deal with both of them. Let us consider another example. This time the example is different from that of the previous examples. It says they determine the value of n and h. When tolerance is given to you, use the composite Simpson rule. We have to find out this integration using the composite Simpson rule, such that our upper bound of the error is 10 raised to the power minus 5. Composite form. A is equal to x naught is 0. B is equal to xn, which is 2. N is not known. H is not known. Both are unknown. So if one is known, we can find out another one. But in this time both are unknown. Let's find out the fourth order derivative of the function. So its derivative is minus 1 divided by x plus 4 whole square. Differentiate it again. Minus 1 into minus 2 will be plus 2 divided by x plus 4 raised to the power 3. Differentiate it again. 2 into minus 3 is minus 6 divided by x plus 4 raised to the power 4. minus 6 into minus 4 is 24 divided by x plus 4 raised to the power 5. This is the fourth order derivative of the function. We will be dealing with the error term only. This is your error term. B minus A. Remember, I'm always telling you that our interest lies in absolute error. So I have taken the absolute value. B is known, which is 2. A is known, which is 0. So this is a B minus A is 2, H raised to the power 4 divided by 180. And fourth order derivative is given by this expression. So replace x by eta, which you can see over here. I'm looking for upper bound of the error. The value of eta lies between 0 and 2. But if you look at this term, we are adjusting this eta in such a way that this term is absolutely maximum. And if you look at this term, this is a decreasing function, because when you are increasing the value of eta, overall the term is decreasing. So maximum value will be at eta is equal to 0. It's just close to 0, but since that is a number which we can't deal with, so that's the reason I substituted x is equal to 0. This will be the value, and it's given to you that this is smaller than 10 raised to the power minus 5. So now let's deal with this portion only and find out the value of h. So h4 is less or equal to 10 raised to the power minus 5, multiply by 180, multiply by 4 raised to the power 5, divided by 2, and 24. When you simplify that one, so you are getting this value. In other words, 2 multiplied by 24 divided by 180 and 4 raised to the power 5 is equal to 3840, which will go to the numerator. And since this power is negative, so it comes down. Now take power h raised to the power, take power 1 over 4. So when you take power 1 over 4, this will become h, and take the power of this term is 1 by 4. So this is the value of h. When the value of h is smaller than this value, when the value of h is smaller than this value, then you will be in the position to find out the upper bound is 10 raised to the power minus 5 for this particular problem. This is one part. We compute, deal with h. Now says that find out n. So you know that xn is equal to x naught plus n into h. X naught is 0. Xn is 2. So 2 is equal to 0 plus n into h. Yeah. N is equal to 2 divided by h. So let us n into h is equal to 2, so h is equal to 2 divided by n. Substitute the value over here. 2 divided by n is less than this quantity. Now let's multiply. N is always a positive number. So multiply both sides by n, and this is a positive number, so divide both sides by this number. So this n will go there, and this number will come here. So you will have n on this side, n is greater than 2 divided by this number. And when you do this calculation, you are seeing that n is greater than 4.5. But remember, n is always an integer, positive integer. Yeah, you can see that this is a natural number. So it will be 5 or more. But remember, you are using the composite Simpson rule. And composite Simpson rule requires that n must be even. So I can't say that n is equal to 5. I will say n is equal to 6. So n will be greater or equal to 6 for this problem to get this amount of accuracy. Remember, n is greater. So accordingly, n should be greater or equal to 5. But Since I'm using the composite form of the Simpson rule and there is a restriction that n must be an even integer, positive integer in this case. So the next even number is 6. So that's the reason I'm saying n is greater or equal to 6. Why? Because in a composite form, we need even number, n should be even. So that is the reason I put n is greater or equal to 6. Now, whatever the value of now n is equal to 6, n is equal to 6. This is the problem. Let's find out its approximated value. Okay, what is the approximated value of this integration when n is 6? I'm not using h. F of x is 1 divided by x plus 4. X naught is 0, x 6 is equal to 2, so h will be x 6 is equal to 2, and x 6 is equal to x naught plus 6 into h, means that h is equal to 2 divided by 6, which is 1 divided by 3. Now, in this particular example, I focus on the value of n. And computed h. If you are focusing on the value of h, then you have to find out n accordingly. When n is equal to 6, so this will become 6 divided by 2, which is equal to 3. This will become 6 minus 2 is equal to 6 minus 2 is equal to 4. 4 divided by 2 is equal to 2. I think it's very simple now. Now do the expansion. I is equal to 1, f of x1. I is equal to 2, f of x3. I is equal to 3, f of x5. We stop here. I is equal to 1, f of x2. I is equal to 2, f of x4. We stop there. Now, everything is known. X0 is 0. X6 is 2. 4 multiplied by x1. X1 is x0 plus h. So, x0 is 0 plus h is 1 divided by 3. F of x2. X1 plus h, 1 divided by 3 plus 1 divided by 3 is 2 divided by 3, x2. X2 plus h is 2 divided by 3 plus 1 divided by 3 is equal to 1, which is x3. And x3 plus h, 1 plus 1 divided by 3 is 4 divided by 3, which is x4. X4 plus h is 4 divided by 3 plus 1 divided by 3, which is 5 divided by 3, which is x5. And we covered on xi's. Just substitute the values. Function is there. Replace x by 0, replace x by 2, replace x by 1 by 3, replace x by 1, replace x by 5 by 3, replace x by 2 by 3, and replace x by 4 by 3, and do the simplification. So this is your approximated value of this integration using the composite form of the Simpson rule. So what you did in this, in one example, n was given to you. You computed h, applied the Simpson rule, composite form. Then a second key example, h was known, you computed the value of n and applied the composite form of the Simpson rule. In the third case, n was unknown, h was unknown, but the upper bound of the error was known. So we computed the value of n, we computed the value of h. And then solve the example by the using the value of n. You can deal with when you select h, the upper bound of h is given to you. Consider any value of h smaller than that number which we derived, and then find out n for that and apply the composite form of the Simpson. So you saw, in all these cases, we are dealing with the integration. We are applying different rules, composite forms, simple forms, and computed the required information which we have to find out. Just a simple substitution. If you understand how I can deal with N, how I can deal with H, formula is there, and you can find out the approximated value of your integration. Inshallah, it will be will not be that difficult. So please go through all these lectures, because your final examination will be coming closer and closer. So do your preparation in parallel, so that during the examination you don't have any problem. Thank you very much.